Do me a favor, open up your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, if you don't have a Bible, there's lots of blue ones on the seats. Make sure you get your eyes on God's Word. That would be very beneficial to you. We started a little while ago preaching through the book of Ephesians. It was a letter God wrote through the Apostle Paul to this faithful followers of Christ, God's holy people, faithful followers. And so he writes this as an encouragement to them. And as I said before, I believe that you guys and gals are a faithful group of followers. And so I think this letter is absolutely apropos for you. Many of you have been here thick and thin, year after year, serving, loving each other, praying for your church, praying for your community. I sense your prayers for me. I appreciate them very much. You are a very faithful group, and so this is for you. We see the first two chapters of the book of Ephesians where Paul is just like pouring out to this group of people all about this amazing salvation that they've received. And he goes through lots of different topics in the first couple of chapters. We talked a lot about them, but he just kind of beautifully outlines this salvation that, you know, once we were far off and we were dead because of our sin and distant from God, and then God reaches down and gives us life, and he places us in Christ in the heavenly, so we're positioned with authority in Christ next to the right hand of the Father. And he talks about his amazing love that was there even before he spoke creation into existence, that he loved us and chose to adopt us and empowered us by putting his Spirit in us, and promises us eternity, and we're members of this family called the church, and it's amazing. And so when Paul gets done, he gets done with chapter 2 here, which there's no chapters when he's writing this, but he was penning this stuff under the inspiration of the Lord, and all of a sudden he's just like overwhelmed with like I can't believe how amazing this salvation is that we've received. Like, this guy's overwhelmed with it. And so you can see in the beginning of chapter 3, he starts out, he's like, when I think of all this, like, it starts to hit him finally. Like, wow, I can't believe all that's happened. Like, I was so ugly, and you all were so ugly and distant and dead, and now we're alive, and we have purpose in our life. Like, I can't believe this. And he's like, when I think of all this, I, Paul, and then he has a rabbit trail. Boom, he goes completely sideways. He doesn't finish his statement. When I think about this, what? You might ask. Well, he finishes the statement in verse 14. You can see it. He says, when I think of all this, I fall to my knees. He's like, I'm just overwhelmed with how amazing this salvation is that I and you guys have received. And I pray. I fall to my knees. Imagine that. Fall to his knees in obedience and love and awe of how incredible God is and how incredible this salvation is that we've received. It is incredible, and he's blown away by it. And so I want to spend a little time, though. I want to read chapter 3, 1 through, 13 maybe. I want to read that with you. Can I do that? Is that cool? You guys got your Bibles open? You better have your Bible open, love. Let me see your Bible. Attaboy. Who's happy Harry's here? Yay! I'm happy Harry's here. It's good to have Harry here. So I'm going to read this with you. Paul's overwhelmed with this salvation and all that God has done for those that are so far. He says, when I think of all this, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the benefit of you Gentiles, rabbit trail, assuming, by the way, that you know God gave me the special responsibility of extending his grace to you Gentiles. As I briefly wrote earlier, God himself revealed his mysterious plan to me. As you read what I have written, you will understand my insight into this plan regarding Christ. God did not reveal it to previous generations, but now by His Spirit He has revealed it to His holy apostles and prophets. And this is God's plan. Both Gentiles and Jews who believe the good news share equally in the riches inherited by God's children. That was a great place for an amen. If you were just looking for a place to express your gratitude to the Lord, I just want to tell you that this is a place that it's okay to yell out. It's all right. No one will shame you. Do you guys want another run at it? Okay. This is God's plan. Both Gentiles and Jews who believe the good news share equally in the riches inherited by God's children. That's it. Both are part of the same body, and both enjoy the promise of blessings because they are united with Christ, or some translations say because they belong to Christ. By God's grace and mighty power, I have been given the privilege of serving Him by spreading this good news. Though I am the least deserving of all God's people, He graciously gave me the privilege of telling the Gentiles about the endless treasures available to them in Christ. I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the Creator of all things, had kept secret from the beginning. God's purpose in all this was to use the church, you guys, to display His wisdom. No one laughed there. That was cool. That was cool. Good. To display His wisdom. Right? Okay. That is funny, right? Us guys. That's amazing. To display His wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was His eternal plan, which He carried out through Christ Jesus our Lord. Because of Christ and our faith in Him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. So, good one. So please don't lose heart because of my many trials here. I am suffering for you, so you should feel honored. One of the things I'm extremely thankful about pastoring this church is that I get to just tell you the truth of God's word and you don't shy away from it. Now, some people do shy away from it, and that's fine. They can. But when I look out here tonight, I don't see a lot of people that I just met. Like, I see one person in this room I just met, and I'm thankful that you're here. But what I do see is a bunch of people that have stayed here. And I don't have a lot of creativity, and I'm not the smartest guy in the world, and I don't tell a whole lot of stories, but I just try to just tell you what it says. But in this world, that's not common. And when I say that, I mean, like, not just churches, but in all things, like in companies and in our presidential election and stuff. You know, to win, to be successful, you want to try to tell some folks what they want to hear, and you want to tell them stuff that they would find appealing, right? If you buy my product because of this reason, like, you wouldn't go up and say, my product is going to give you gas, here, buy it. Like, that's not really the way to be successful, right? So, but what we're charged to do if we're a minister of the gospel is to give the full counsel of God, like, to just, this is what the Bible says. And so I've been blessed because you guys, I wouldn't say that you allow it, but because I'm going to do it, but you keep coming. And I sense that you want the truth of God's word, and that even though we fail at accomplishing it often, it is your heart's desire to actually live up to what this book says. I believe that of you. I do. And I'm right there with you. I read it, I want to do it, and I fail. But I get right back up, right? And we do it again, and we try and try and try. And by God's grace, we'll be successful in a greater measure. But I say all that because I want to share with you something that is not, it wouldn't seem on the surface that it's like, hey, this is what I'd like to be. This is good news. This would make me happy. Like, it doesn't seem to be like that. But I think that by the end of the night, I think that you will receive what God's word says. And at first you might say, well, that's not good. But I realize if that's what God wants, then it really is good. And I want that. Okay? I'm going to talk to you about something that we heard in this short reading that I did in Ephesians chapter 3. I'm just going to highlight the verses where it appeared, and then we'll talk about it. Right there in the first verse, look what it says. When I think of all this, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the benefit of the Gentiles. Verse 7, by God's grace and mighty power, I have been given the privilege of serving him by spreading this good news. And then, verse 13, remember, though, when I'm about to read this to you, he just said it's a privilege, right? It's a privilege. Is a privilege a good thing? Right? Your mom and dad give you a privilege that you don't normally get. It's a good thing, right? Okay, look what he says in verse 13. It's a privilege of preaching, right? So please don't lose heart because of my many trials here. I am suffering for you. You got to understand something, that he's talking about a privilege that's not erased because he's suffering. He said to follow me as I follow Christ. And he's saying it's a privilege to serve him even if he's suffering. Like, that doesn't seem right to me. When I read it at first, I was like, I want good stuff in my life. But he says to follow me as I follow Christ. My privilege is to suffer for Christ. My privilege is to be a prisoner of Jesus Christ. My privilege is to be a servant or a slave of Christ, even if the circumstances are bad. You know that most of these letters were written while he was in jail. The word servant is the Greek word doulos, and it's servant, slave, bond servant, in bonds, you know. The word prisoner, similar word, but a little bit different, but it's desmios, and it's also, though, in bonds. Think of that person in shackles, right? In shackles. Now, that's not something that you grow up aspiring to be. I would love to be a prisoner when I grow up. I would love to be a slave when I grow up. Like, that's not something we would endeavor to do, but it's something that Paul says here is a privilege. The idea of being a slave of Christ or a slave of God is not uncommon in the New Testament. Romans 1:1 says the same thing. Ephesians 3:1, same thing. Paul, a prisoner or a servant or a slave. Philippians 1:1, I, Paul, and Timothy, a slave, a servant. Titus 1:1, Paul says the same thing, a slave of God. James 1:1, different person, same Holy Spirit, same attitude. I'm a slave of Christ. Remember something too, this is Jesus' half-brother. I see two brothers in the room here tonight. I see two groups of brothers. What would it take, Eric, for you to say you're a slave to Michael or vice versa? Laughable. What would it take, right, to be a slave of Harry or vice versa? So there must have been something crazy going on for James and Jude, who we see in his letter, same thing. I, a slave of Christ, happy to be the slave of their brother. 2 Peter chapter 1:1 also, Peter says it. I, a slave of Christ. You go back into the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 1. He doesn't say he's a prisoner of Christ. He says, first of all, he says, I'm a prisoner of Christ. And then 4:1, he says, I'm a prisoner for serving Christ. Because I'm a prisoner of Christ, I'm also a prisoner of the government. Because I'm serving Christ. In Philemon, same thing. Paul writes this. He says, I am a prisoner for preaching the good news of Christ. I don't know about you guys, to me it wouldn't seem on the surface as something of good report if it puts me in the can. It just doesn't. It doesn't seem right to me. But it was to Paul. Paul was pleased that he could be in jail for the good news. As a matter of fact, it also says in Revelation 1:1, if you have a Bible, you can turn there, look at Revelation 1:1, and look what John says. We see all these other authors of Scripture saying this. What does he say in chapter 1, This is the revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the events that must soon take place. Who's that? Who's the servants? Raise your hand. You, right? You. He sent an angel to present this revelation to his servant, John. So all these guys, Paul, James, Peter, Jude, and John, all acknowledging and embracing the title of a slave or a servant or a prisoner. And Paul says, it's a privilege. It's a privilege. What do you do? Well, you might ask someone, I don't know, I'm a real estate agent or something. And how about you? What do you do? What God says. What do you do for, what do you do? I paint lines in the highway. And you? Whatever God says. What do you do? I'm a fitness instructor. What do you do? Whatever God says, whatever God wants. I'm his slave. I'm his servant. I'm his prisoner. I have willfully subjected myself to the lordship of Christ Jesus. Jesus is my master. He says, jump, and you say, no, you don't. You don't say anything. You jump. You jump. You don't, you listen, no clarity is deserved or needed. No direction is required. You don't ask him how high. You don't ask him how long. He says, jump. What do? Come on. You jump. You just start jumping because you've subjected yourself to the lordship of Christ. And when he says move, what do? You start moving. You know, he told Abraham to move. In other words, he said, Abraham, I need you to jump. And Abraham didn't say, hey, well, where am I going? What am I going to do when I get there? Do I have a nice place? Do you have a tent for me? What's going to be? No. Abraham, move. And then I'll tell you what's up. Move. And so when God says jump, we just do it. We just do it. We don't ask questions, okay? So I would just say this, that being a slave or a servant or a prisoner, not desirable in today's culture, right? That's not something anyone would really aspire to be. A slave, a servant, a prisoner, these titles carry with it immediate and complete compliance to the will of another. And we talked about this the last couple weeks. How many people, show of hands in the room, like to be told what to do? Liar. You told me earlier today you don't like to be told what to do. You stinking liar, right? He's telling the truth now, so he repented. Repent. Nobody likes to be told what to do, but to be a slave, a servant, a prisoner, you absolutely, willingly give in to the will of another without option. The thought of my own desires are not considered. My tastes are not at the top of the list. My opinion means nothing. This, beloved, speaks of the lordship of Jesus Christ in your life. And so there's a problem, and here's the problem. The problem is that we live in a world that's aimed at destroying us by feeding this monster of me. That you are immersed in a me world. Immersed in a me world. Countless, listen, all around us, right? Countless goods and services that are there, plain and simple, with the intention of pleasing you. And making your life easier and happy, what you like, what makes you happy, satisfy your every whim. I mean, you just see it all around you. I mean, if you leave this place right here and you just drive to our new location, how many restaurants do you see? How many people in here have genuinely, I mean, over the last year, been genuinely hungry? Like, no, I'm not talking because you were fasting on purpose, just so hungry because you haven't eaten. Where would I eat? What would I do? You have? No, you weren't. Yeah. Options, right? There's all different options available to make you happy. And then when you get in the restaurant, what do they do? more options. Here's a menu, sir. Pick and choose whatever you want. I'll tell you right now, I mean, you can hate, but I could kill some fried chicken right now. And I was thinking about that. It's popping into my mind. I'm a sinner. I'm thinking about fried chicken right now. I would kill KFC. I would kill KFC. Who's with me? Come on now, right? Repent. You buy a house, like I've done this. You buy a house, and what do? You go to the builder, and they sit you down, and they got the big book, and just pick and choose whatever you want. Whatever makes you happy, sir. Whatever makes you happy, ma'am. You go to the car dealership, same thing. Every car looks the same, from Hyundai to Lexus, they all look the same. But you can go in and you can pick out any type of seating configuration, any kind of radio you want. You want leather, you want cloth, you want power this, every color, anything you want, make you happy. Every single thing. You go to the mall. I don't do this too often, but I've been there. You go to the mall, store after store after store after store after store after store, clothing, 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 every style, every color, every price point, just endless, all intended to make you happy. The choice is yours. You do what you want. Makes me happy. You know, I came across some interesting statistics this week as I was spending time studying, preparing, share this with you. These numbers are staggering. Do you know that us, Americans right here, not just you, I know you, we spent $10.7 trillion buying stuff last year. $10.7 trillion consuming stuff to make us happy. Here's some interesting ones. $96 billion were spent on beer. $96 billion. America. We're so bad we buy foreign beer. Right? Trying to escape something, right? $10 billion in romance novels. Trying to find something, right? $11 billion on engagement and wedding rings. Let me just give you guys advice. See that right there? $80 for two. If you're thinking about popping the question to someone, right there, $80 for two. Someone might say amen here, $16 billion on chocolate. $34.6 billion gambling. Trying to find something, right? Why? Gamble, gamble, gamble so I can give everybody some money? No, generally not. I said to get these little tattoos for $80, right? $2.3 billion on ink. $500 million on golf balls. $500 billion invested on neglecting your wife. I didn't say that out loud, but that's what it is. Americans spent $25.5 billion on professional sports last year. Going to games, buying the shirts. This one's crazy. $18 billion in credit card late fees. Like that's not the interest. I mean, the interest is bad enough. Okay, just the late fees alone, $18 billion. Why? Generally speaking, why? I want, I need, I will have $18 billion. And for the DiGiacomos and the Johnsons, I did this for you. $40 billion spent on lawn service. Woo! Not all to you, and not all to you. A very small portion of the $40 billion. You can't even see it. What's that? Woo! Listen, son, listen. I and you do not need the latest technology to make us happy. What we really, really need is God's promise that all things will work out for the good to those who love him and are called to his purpose. That should be what is pleasing to your soul. I choose to not pursue my own pleasures. Instead, I choose to pursue God's mission to reach the hopeless with the gospel. America has these three rights, if you will. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And they're good. They are very good. We should embrace those. But what I'm asking you, and I believe the scriptures is pleading with you to do, is in your pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, is to have some new rules for this pursuit of happiness and a new master for this pursuit of happiness. See, some of us have discovered this new happy. And it pours down like rain and a flood when we finally find it. And it's because we do not live for ourselves anymore. We live for him. But I can tell you right now, I can safely say that some of you, even in this room, have not found that. You've not found it. And Jesus warns us that his road is very narrow and very few find it. And I know that. And some of you haven't found that. And I pray God's Spirit leads you in that direction tonight. See, this is the what of slavery. This is what it means to be a slave or a servant or a prisoner of Christ Jesus. It's the willful surrender of my life to the lordship of Jesus Christ. It's the willful surrender. It's willingly saying, turning myself in. I'm here. I'm in. It's not a hostile takeover lordship that you will do this. No, it's me willingly turning myself in loving response to this amazing God who went to the cross and became your sin and accepted your punishment so you would have life. It's a willful obedience. I will turn myself in. You don't have to come after me anymore, Lord. I'm giving myself over to you. The Bible says that my sheep, Jesus said, will know my voice. And I'll know them, and they'll follow me. And what scared me this week is I think about all the people that go to church that do not follow him. And when the word of God, whether it's at this church or any other, the man stands up and he preaches the word of God to you and you have no intention of following it. You're just there for a check mark. You want to get out of there because it's dinner time or lunch time. And you have no intention of following it, or you have an intention to, but you don't make any effort to do so. You're not hearing his voice. You are not following him. And what scares me is if the ones who hear his voice and follow him are his, the ones that don't, you need to check yourself. You can call yourself a Christian all day. That doesn't mean you are. You can sit in a garage and you're not a car. Just the way it is. And so his sheep will hear his voice. And so when the word of God is proclaimed, it is your heart's desire to follow it. I read this book and I want to do what it says. That's lordship. That's lordship. The only response to this love that he showed us on the cross is to willingly bow your will to Jesus Christ as Lord of your life. And that's it. That's what being a servant is. Now, that's the what. That's what a servant is. But I'm going to give you three whys you should. Are you ready? Okay, so you jot this one. This is the first one. I love this one, but that's just me. It's obedience. It's obedience. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. Raw obedience. God, I've heard it said, is not one to offer suggestions too often. He proclaims some commands and says, this is what I want. So I want to ask you to make a decision to live God's way, not your own. So when he says, when I say obedience, I want to tell you what I'm talking about. He's not giving a suggestion. In Romans chapter 12:1 tells us this. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. You see, a moment ago I said that it's not a hostile takeover lordship, it's a willing surrender. I'm turning myself in because you're responding to this love that was shown to you. And you see what God says. He says, I'm pleading with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. See, it's not because you have to. It's you consider all that he has done for you and you just willingly give yourself. And he doesn't say, well, you know what? After all he's done for you, you know what? You might want to consider this. This might be a good option of many. Maybe you could give yourself completely to him. He says something about half-hearted worship and partial commitment and just a little sacrifice. He says, after all he's done for you, let your bodies, let yourself be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. Some translations say that's your reasonable worship. So here's all he's done for you. So just imagine on one side of the scale is the cross, right? And his desire to go there for you to save you, right? And all the torture and everything he went through, right? Over there, that's on this side of the scale. In light of that, what are you going to put on your end of the scale? Partial submission? On occasion? Maybe I'll pick and choose? Or are we just like completely, he was completely all in, wasn't he? And so he's asking you to do the same exact thing. And he says, give your body. He doesn't say think about giving, give it. Give it. And so that's the heart of God. Give it. But the heart of Paul, the preacher, what does he say? Look at his beautiful words. He's like, I plead with you. That's locked. I plead with you. You see him begging the people? See, in the first couple of chapters of Romans, he starts, just like he did in Ephesus, he starts telling people about what God's done for them. And he's like, I'm pleading with you in light of all that God has done for you. Like, I'm pleading. This is the best thing for you. God says, give it. But he, Paul, pleads. I beg. It's so good for you to do this. Please give yourself to him. I know this is the best thing for you. He's pleading. Give yourself completely to God. Give yourself over to the authority of someone else completely. Proverbs 3:5 also, lean not on your own understanding, but seek God's will in all that you do. Not your own, not your own style, not your own preference, not your own ideas, not your own wisdom. No, seek God. Give yourself to him. Not what you want, but what he wants. Peter says something similar in 1 Peter 5:6. Humble yourself under the mighty power of God. God, you know best, I don't. I give myself to you. You tell me what to do, and I'll do it. Scriptures are adamant about this. For all he has done, because of the cross, because you respond in love to his love, you choose to obey him, a willing submission to the lordship of Jesus Christ. James would say it this way, don't just be hearers. Don't just be hearers of the word. Don't just read the Bible and say, I read it, I'm good. No. Reading it's the start. But that's the start of the race. What's the finish of the race? Doing it. And don't just be hearers. Don't just get this guy up here up front who's reading verses to you and hearing it goes, all right, awesome. I heard it. I listened. I wasn't in the other room. I paid attention. No, that's just the beginning. Don't be just hearers of the word. Be doers of the word. That's the plea. James would say, don't be hearers, but be doers. Revolution people would say, open it, read it, and what? And do it. Same thing. See, that wasn't just out of the clouds. That was from the Bible. So the first thing, the reason why we give ourselves as a servant, as a slave, as a prisoner of God is out of obedience. He tells us to. Here's the second thing. Jot this down. This is awesome too. It's who Jesus is. You know, Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. So the biblical mandate is to do what Jesus does, right? Listen, this is profound. You've never heard this before. It's amazing. You're right. This is awesome stuff. Christ followers follow Christ. Huge, right? Tweet that one. That's a good one. But it's true. It's true. Jesus is this. He's a servant. John 5:30, Jesus says this himself. I carry out the will of the one who sent me, not my own will. So here's Jesus, 100% just like me and you, flesh and bones, person. 100% God. The scriptures say that all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell in Christ. He was not like deficient in any way as a man walking here on this earth. Like he was complete deity, 100%, 100% of the time, and still is. But he was also a man at the same time. I don't expect me to explain that to you, but he was. But as a man, he submits to the will of God. He's a servant to the Lord. Well-known section of scripture you'll find in Luke 23 where he's about to go to the cross. He's about to be spit on and stripped down naked publicly and slapped and whipped and dismembered, like they're ripping his flesh off his body and spiked and killed, right? So he's no duh. He's like, Dad, is there any other way? Can you please take this cup of suffering from me? And he doesn't even wait for his father's answer. He's like, yeah, but your will be done, not mine. Like he vented. He vented. It's okay. But he immediately said, yeah, but it doesn't matter what I think. It matters what you think. His immediate future, think about it. I mean, you all know the story now. The immediate future for Christ was nothing enjoyable, nothing pleasant, nothing fun in his immediate future. But his words say, listen, Dad, my opinion means nothing. My comfort and my pleasure mean nothing, and I will bow to the will of the one who sent me. That's Jesus Christ. A servant, a slave, or a prisoner has no options. And that's scary to Americans. It's scary to me. To have no options available to me, to be completely under the authority of another at all times, in all things. Not easy. Philippians 2:7 says, Jesus gave up his divine privileges and took the humble position of a slave, and in obedience died a criminal's death on a cross. Now you got to look at the words here. I said to be a slave or a prisoner is something that you willfully do. You turn yourself in. And look what it says. Didn't say Jesus was forced, did it? No, he gave up his divine privileges. Here's my card, Dad. I'm giving up my spot. He said, I gave up my divine privileges. He willingly laid down his privilege of being God for that time. Said, I don't need to do this, but I'm going to. I'm going to submit willfully to this call in my life. And he says, I gave up my position, and he took on the humble position of a slave. So it was his will. He's like, listen, I'm going to do this. I will be a slave. I will be a servant. I will do as I'm supposed to do according to your plan, Father, and I will die in obedience to you, a torturous criminal death on a cross. Matthew 20:28 says, I came to serve others, not to be served. And so you can see Jesus, not only is he serving the Father, the one who sent him, so he's serving vertically, right? He's also serving horizontally. He's serving his Father. He's serving you. He's serving me. He was serving them. That's who Jesus Christ is. He gave his life up to teach. While he was living, that's what he did. He gave his life to teach people and heal people and feed people. He washed their feet. He washed Judas's feet, even though he knew that that was the guy who was going to send him up the river. He washed them anyway. He calmed storms. He cast out demons, all to serve us. And then he literally lays down his life by providing the ultimate service to us. The forgiveness of sin, heaven eternal, reconciled to the Father by his death, burial, and resurrection. That's Jesus Christ the Lord. And we're to be servants just like him. I said there was three whys, right? The first one was obedience. The second one is because Christ ultimately is our example. We do as Christ is. Now the third one's a little bit different because it's instead of telling you why you should be a slave or a servant or a prisoner or whatever, I'm going to tell you why not. And the why not is not for praise. We don't become a prisoner of Christ for praise from others. Look at me. I'm a slave of Jesus. Don't you hate that guy? Oh. Well, Jesus didn't hate him, but he had a lot to say about people like that. Look at me. I'm holy. Matthew 6 and Matthew 23 are absolutely filled with these religious folks that are displaying this look at me, look at me, look at me thing. Jesus harshly rebukes the look at me, I'm a slave of Jesus guy, boasting of one's religious prowess. In Matthew 23, verse 11, go there. Matthew 23:11. It's roasting in here. Goodness gracious. Jesus says in Matthew 23:11, paraphrase, but you can read it right there, put your eyes on it. Jesus says, you want to be great? Don't brag about your religious prowess. Be a humble servant. Be a humble servant. The religious folks, they sought to be praised, not to be a prisoner. They wanted to be significant, not servants. It's a privilege to serve. It's a privilege to serve. It's a privilege to serve God, and it's a privilege to serve the body of Christ. And praise from others must be out of the question. Like you can't serve the Lord and humble yourself to be a servant for the praise of people. I want to share something with you. And I think that this, I can give you some illustrations and stuff, but biblical illustrations are the best illustrations. Amen? So if you look in Luke 17, I want you to put your eyes on something. Luke 17, look at verse 7. So I said one is obedience. One is because that's what Jesus is presently. And we should be like that. And the second one is don't do it for praise. So Jesus is speaking. And he's got some people in front of him. They're his apostles. And they ask him a question, which is an amazingly good question. And I would love it if you guys all would ask God the same question. And he's willing to answer it. The apostles said to the Lord in verse 5, he says, show us how to increase our faith. Talks about the old mustard seed there, right? And it just kind of goes sideways. It doesn't appear to be connected, but it is because Jesus said it. He says, when a servant comes in from plowing or taking care of sheep, does his master say, come in and eat with me? No. He says, prepare my meal, put on your apron and serve me while I eat. Then you can eat later. And does the master thank the servant for doing what he was told to do? Of course not. See, that's parabolic because they're not in that situation in that moment, are they? There's no master there preparing a dinner. There's no aprons. There's nothing. It's a parable. He's trying to teach you something, making a point, right? Do you guys get this? But then look what he says. It goes from being parabolic to straight up in your face teaching to those people right then and there. And you can see it in his words. With the parable in mind, he says, in the same way, like what I just shared with you in this illustration, if you will, in the same way, when you obey me, you should say, we are unworthy servants who have simply done our duty. There's no such thing as super Christian. There's no such thing as, look at him, look at me, look at her. Listen, the Apostle Paul, who God personally visited and inspired to write half the New Testament, has told you, follow me as I follow Christ. That just as Paul was, you could be the same. You should be the same. God wants you to be the same. Radical obedience to the word of God. His Spirit says, move, you move. He says, jump, you jump. That's what you're supposed to do. You are supposed to be just like Paul was. Like, there's no super Christians. He wants us, if there's supposed to be a super Christian, he wants all of us to be super Christians. No one's up here because you graduated seminary, and I'm here because I didn't graduate high school. If you have said yes to Christ, his Spirit lives in you, same thing. Equal. It's all the same, right? So no one's called to be awesome, and you could look at that person and go, man, this guy here, man, I could never be like, no. Same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in him, lives in you, lives in you. I could go down everyone in here. Same power, available. And so what he's saying here in this text is, it's not to be praised. That's what you do. When you've said yes to the Lordship of Christ, with that yes comes with obedience to God's word. I will be a servant of Christ Jesus. If he is your Lord, right? This is easy, but follow. If he's your Lord, then that means when he says something, you do it, right? Right? How many people work for somebody else? Raise your hand. How many times can you disobey what they say before you don't work for them anymore? Not often. So if you disobey that person, you raise your hand, Kat, if you disobeyed that person and got fired for being disobedient, could she still say, well, she's fired now. Kat, what do? I work at Waterman Village. No, you don't. You got fired. Well, no, I work at Waterman. No, you didn't. You were disobedient and they fired you. They're no longer your boss. You can't call yourself a Christian and say Jesus is your Lord if he ain't. My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. And that's what he's called you to be a servant of Christ Jesus. And so just like Paul, who realized that he was so undeserving, but by God's grace and his mighty power, he had been given the privilege, right? The privilege of serving God by spreading the good news. Now listen, we're about to be done, but I want you to hear this. He'd been given the privilege of serving God even though he was suffering. See, oftentimes, serving and suffering go hand in hand. That just because you choose to say yes to Christ and choose to radically obey him and become his servant, that doesn't mean all things are going to go well. Paul spent much time in prison for being a slave of Christ. And so what God's calling you to tonight is that he wants you to have that same perspective. You shouldn't be begged to serve. You shouldn't be begged to serve. When he says jump, we don't need to ask for clarity. We don't need to command direction. You shouldn't have to ask and wait, waiting on the Lord, to find something that you like to do or that you have time to do. He said, jump. So jump. As the band comes up, we're going to close, but I want to pray with you now. I feel, Lord, led to not just for myself, but all of those that would join me in this, to start our prayer with a plea for forgiveness. A plea to ask for your forgiveness for our lack of obedience. For treating your salvation as if it was common. For not including the lordship of Christ into the salvation of Christ. Oh, the long hours of your Spirit's pleading on our heart as we ignored him. All the times you've asked us to do something, all the times you've commanded us to do something, and yet we've turned away from you too often. Father, would you forgive? Your word tells us there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ, and so we receive your forgiveness now. If you want to receive it, I just pray as a symbol of your willingness and your desire to receive from the Father forgiveness. Just open your hands and let him pour into you. Let him know it's you that wants forgiveness. Lord, we are in a battle. Day in and day out, a relentless pursuit of the world and the evil desires and temptations and all these things that are designed to steal, kill, and destroy. But you said you came that we might have life. And that's what we want. Lord, would you redefine our pursuit of happiness? Your word tells us to not copy the behaviors and customs of this world, but let God transform us into a new person by changing the way we think. And so we want to exercise that right now. We want to let you change the way we think. Redefine happiness for us. Redefine who we are. Let us embrace the title of slave of Christ. Take away our desires. Take away our opinions. Take away our style. Take away our preference. Take away our bad attitude, myself most. And help me and help us all to give in to the lordship of Jesus Christ. for all that he has done for us. Let us give ourselves completely to the service of Christ Jesus. Help us not to seek the praise of men, but to seek the praise of only one who will one day look at us and say, "Well done, faithful servant." Help us to be reminded of that and make that be the pursuit of our life, to one day hear those beautiful words spoken over us.